Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. Let us continue our discussion of the history of the Jews of Ashkenaz by looking at the impact of the church, particularly in the crucial 13th century. This is a period when the church was ascendant in its conflict with temporal powers and their jockeying for power. The church begins to really get a major leg up in the 13th century. You know, the Crusades were a major step forward for the church's authority and power and its ability to unite all of Europe under a single cause. Of course, that's all of Christian Europe, which is basically all of Europe. The Jews were not necessarily so thrilled with the Crusades, and then there would be other issues as well. But for the most part, the notion that the church should have authority over kings was something that really showed its peak in the 13th century. How does that relate to Jews? Well, let's just have a look at a couple of pieces of art to illustrate this, and then we're going to look at a little bit of theology and specifically look at the reign of Innocent III, a somewhat ironically named pope of the early 13th century. This is a classic representation of what's called the Ecclesia et Synagoga depiction, the church and synagogue. This is an example from the Notre Dame Cathedral before it was burned down. I wonder what it'll look like when they've restored it. But basically, this is a piece of monumental architecture, which was essentially a kind of visual text for illiterate peasants who would be able to come to the cathedral and would be able to understand something about the nature of the church and its relationship to Jews and Judaism. This was in many ways a kind of a visual expression of something called the doctrine of witness that we've discussed in previous classes, but let's go into a little bit more detail today. So you have two female figures, symbolic representing on the left the church and on the right the synagogue. The reason why the church is always on the left, which is normally the weaker side in Western thought, is because these images are often placed in the context of a view of the crucifixion, the passion scene. So the crucifixion happens in the center, and the church, which is on our left, is actually on the right of Jesus, and the synagogue would be on the left. So that's why the left represented weaker and so on. So here you can see on the left, the church, and there's a few key features. She has, for example, her crown is on her head, properly styled. She's holding on to the chalice. She's got a staff that represents authority and power. And contrast this with the synagogue, who is typically without a crown or a crown falling off her head. She is typically blindfolded, meaning she's unable to see the truth of Christianity. In this image, she is dramatically blindfolded by a serpent that covers her eyes. Obviously, you know, hearkening back to the original sin and the book of Genesis, her staff is broken, indicating that her powers are failing. And she is holding the commandments. It looks like there's actually quite a few more than 10 here. I see 4 tablets, which makes me think there's like 20 commandments. We have enough, I think. But she's holding them in a very weak way, indicating that she's not even holding onto her own religion well. It's going to fall out of her hands. And there are literally hundreds of examples of this Ecclesia et Synagoga in medieval art. You see a lot of it in the 13th century onward, when the church is especially strong and is broadcasting this message to say, in general, that the church is favored. The Jews, who you might have heard of them as the chosen people, forget that stuff. They are no longer chosen. It is the church that is ascendant and demands your loyalty. Here's another example, a very powerful one from Spain. Here's one that shows a very beautiful, clear-eyed, you know, visionary woman on the left representing the church, and on the right, a haggard old crone, once again blindfolded with the claw-like hands holding onto the tablet. You know, it's meant to be one of appeal for the church and disdain for the synagogue. And here is one that is from Strasbourg, that is one of the most famous. Sometimes these are called the Strasbourg Sisters. And it's interesting because the church is shown here kind of like looking daggers at her sister. You know, I think it's a rather unappealing kind of image. Like, you don't like her. She's very judgy, so to speak. And synagoga has a much more graceful kind of form, but it is she is in an attitude, in a posture of decline. She is literally falling away from the rock, which indicates the, you know, the collapse, decline of Judaism. All these things, I think, give the very consistent message. Here's one that's just shocking in nature. This is a stained glass window from Verben, Germany. Here you can see the full crucifixion scene. And on our left, you see the church sitting on a tetramorph, like a four-headed animal, which is kind of like evocative of the book of Ezekiel. And a hand descends from heaven and places a throne on her head. The synagogue, on the other hand, is riding a donkey or a mule, a sterile animal, holding on to a ram's horn, which is on the one hand, you know, a reference to the binding of Isaac. But in this context, it's viewed as a sign of the carnal nature of the Jews being trapped in the whole cycle of sacrifices and blood and things like that. It's meant as a criticism. And the usual symbols like the blindfold and the broken staff and the crown knocked off the head. But I think what's most dramatic is there, whereas the church gets a hand descending from heaven and placing a crown on the head of the church, the synagogue gets a sword driven through the top of the skull, which is pretty nasty and hard to mistake the intention there. So these images are really a medieval expression of doctrines that were developed hundreds of years earlier, starting perhaps with Justin Martyr, shown in this image as Justin the philosopher, who lived in the second century, and he has some dialogues with a rabbi named Trypho, not the Tarfon that is mentioned in Pirkei Avos. And there you see some of the basic themes of a carnal Israel, the Christians as the true Israel, meaning the Jews are not the Jews, the Christians are now the Jews, that why don't the Jews convert to Christianity? Well, they're obdurate, they refuse, they're stubborn, and so on. We see it also in St. John Chrysostom of Antioch in the 4th century, who was one of the pioneers of the adversus Judaeos tradition, that is the idea of using sermons to specifically attack the Jews and to kind of defend Christianity, especially for a lot of new Christians who are not exactly sure what is Christianity all about. And I mean, as you're trying to adopt a new religion, how do you do this religion? And if there's any awareness of the connection between Christianity and Judaism, so people say, well, you know what? The Jews rest on Sabbath. I kind of like the way they do that. I'm going to do that too. And Chrysostom in particular railed against these kind of practices. But it's interesting that from his complaints, you get a sense of what must have been happening in Antioch in the 4th century, that apparently Christians were going to Jewish synagogues, they were participating in Jewish Yom Tov, they were even engaging in prayer with them, they were eating, you know, the holiday foods and things like that, and this was like, you know, Chrysostom really wanted to put a stop to it and separate them. But what I think is most important to understand, even though we can talk about the conflict between the church and the synagogue, what's really crucial is that St. Augustine of Hippo, who was a rough contemporary with St. John Chrysostom, had a very different kind of view of the place of Jews in an increasingly Christianized Europe. Specifically, he viewed the fact that God had a relationship with the Jews as a sort of like foundation for Christianity. You refer to Judaism as the desk of Christianity, right? You put your papers and you write upon the desk. So the Judaism is sort of like the foundation. And in fact, he validated the continuing observance of the Torah by the Jews as a positive sign indicating their faithfulness and so on. Now, he did certainly believe that they were wrong for not adopting Christianity, but he said that it would be very wrong for Christians to somehow, you know, God forbid, kill the Jews. Not only is this a clear violation of thou shalt not murder, among other things, but it also represents a stumbling block before the ultimate justification of the truth of Christianity. That's the idea of what he called the doctrine of witness, which basically means the Jews must be kept alive until the second coming of Jesus, so that the Jews who were the original Jews, the original people to whom Jesus preached, would be able to somehow confirm that, yes, this is the Messiah that we have been waiting a long time for. Now, if there were no Jews around to do that, Christians would never, ever really know for sure if that was true. I've talked about this in many other classes, so I don't want to go into it in more detail here. But it's kind of like, you know, if you think of it like here, I'm an iPhone user. I like my iPhone a lot. And I use it all the time, and I've been an iPhone user for many, many years. If someone were to give me a Samsung and I were to say, wow, this is so much better than my iPhone, I'm never going back, that would be a huge win for Samsung. But if, on the other hand, I was already a Samsung user, and then you gave me a new Samsung, I would say, okay, yeah, this is definitely improvement, but I don't really know if it's better than the iPhone. Right? The only way I know is if I was originally an iPhone user and then I switched, then I could validate the Samsung choices. So that's essentially how St. Augustine envisioned this doctrine of witness. But there was a big downside to it, and we see this very clearly in the 13th century. The downside is that the whole system only works if the Jews are in a slightly degraded state, meaning if the Jews are successful and profitable and prosperous and happy and all kinds of things like that, then their constant presence while Christians wait for the second coming is corrosive to Christian faith. And people would say, well, wait a second, you know, why are we doing, like, why aren't we eating, you know, meat during Lent? I mean, the Jews are eating meat and they look pretty happy, you know? So all kinds of things like that. It only works, the whole doctrine of witness only works if the Jews are socioeconomically on a lower status and that Christians see that, oh, they're being continually punished for their obduracy, for their refusal to accept Christianity. And then when the Messiah comes, then they'll be able to confirm his status. Now, this is actually not so bad in many ways. As one of my teachers, Professor Alan Davies of the University of Toronto, said, in many ways, the church preserved the Jews for 1,500 years because this allowed them a space in Augustinian doctrine to exist in Europe as a minority. It made it difficult for them to excel, and anti-Semitic legislation held them back as a result, but they were allowed to exist, and in fact, it was considered a crime to do anything to harm them beyond that ill-defined boundary. This brings us up to the 13th century, and we'll conclude with a discussion of Innocent III. He reigned from the years 1198 to 1216, and he represents in many ways the high point of medieval church power. One of the ways in which he expressed his power was through the Fourth Lateran Council that met in 1215 that issued a whole slew of anti-Jewish regulation because he felt that the Augustinian doctrine of witness had kind of like ignored the prosperity of the Jews. And he felt that the Jews had to be put back in their place. And he instituted all kinds of negative anti-Jewish legislation in the church, perhaps the most significant of which was the imposition of the Jewish badge in order to prevent the communication of Jews with non-Jews and the development of a, you know, a civic society in which they are all relatively equal. He said Christians have to always be aware that Jews are separate, and he demanded that they wear some kind of, indication of their separateness on their clothing. In some places, this was a round badge called a ruel that was a sort of a reference to the coin that Judas received for betraying Jesus. The name Judas and the name Jews sounded very similar. It was easy to kind of associate them in that way. But in other places, different symbols were used. Sometimes it was in the shape of tablets of law, sometimes in the shape of with a drawing of a pig on it. And there's a significant amount of debate over the possibility of the use of a Jewish hat. We know for sure that the Jews in medieval art were depicted with these strange sort of triangular hats, but it's not clear if this was simply a convention of art and artists as a way of labeling people as Jewish, or whether it was actually something that Jews were required to wear. At any rate, this is the period of Innocent III and relates very much to the next subject we're going to have to discuss, which is unfortunately the advance of very significant Jew hatred in the 13th century. Thank you very much for watching.